Rivalries make for great stories. We love tales of clashes between competing sports teams, dueling individuals, or opposing ideas, partly because we know that rivalries also make for greatness, challenging us to do better. Take the War of the Currents that gripped 1880s America when the inventors, Thomas Edison and George Westinghouse, raced to pull off the engineering challenge of the age, bringing electricity to cities and industries. This wasn't just a battle of the brands, but a struggle over how best to harness electricity, with Edison favoring a system called direct current and Westinghouse championing alternating current. The competition was brutal, but with the help of Serbian whiz kid Nikola Tesla, Westinghouse ultimately won the war, laying the groundwork for AC grids that today bring power to more than 7 billion people. But that's not the end of the story. DC didn't die completely. The device you're watching this on uses it. So do microwaves, TVs, LEDs. Ironically, the battery in a Tesla car charges 8 times faster with DC than it does with Nikola Tesla's preferred AC. So what gives? If AC won the war, why is DC everywhere? It's all down to direction, specifically the direction in which electrons move through a circuit. With DC, they flow in one direction, from the negative to the positive end of a battery, for instance. Whereas with AC, they keep reversing direction, alternating 50 or 60 times a second. Neither system is inherently better than the other, but they are better suited to different purposes. For example, because of the way digital hardware works, your computer needs the steady flow of DC. But for it to work at all, you first need to get electricity to your house. And in the 1880s, that's where AC had the edge. You see, to send an electrical charge a long way, it needs a big push, or in technical terms, a high voltage. Back then, this was easier to do with AC than with DC, meaning Westinghouse could generate power from Niagara Falls and send it 32 kilometers to Buffalo, whereas Edison, limited to shorter distances, needed generators all over town. So, each system was put to use according to its strengths. And today, our power stations and grids are mostly AC, our devices are increasingly DC, and our homes are littered with adapters to convert one into the other. A functional, if clunky, hybrid system based on the limitations of 19th century technology. However, it's now the 21st century, and as technology has evolved, so have the strengths and weaknesses of these two systems, giving us the chance to reconsider these old ideas in light of the new challenges we face. For instance, as of 2022, almost a billion people worldwide still don't have access to electricity, something the UN aims to fix by 2030. But at the same time, we're living through a climate emergency caused by our reliance on non-renewable energy. So how can we both expand power consumption and limit its impact on the environment? As it turns out, DC could help with both. Firstly, one of our main sources of renewable power is DC by default. When sunlight hits the cells in a solar panel, it energizes their electrons, pushing them in one direction and creating a direct current. This can be converted to AC and sent to the grid, but there's another option, turning Edison's weakness, the need to generate power near the point of use, into a strength, and building what's known as a microgrid, with solar panels on the roof of, say, an office block, powering its computers and LED lighting, and minimizing the need for inefficient DC-AC-DC conversion. This idea is even more important for countries with low electricity access, because they're mostly located in parts of the world with lots of sunshine but little AC grid infrastructure. With solar-powered microgrids, though, they can produce their own clean, cheap, reliable energy. What's more, solar-rich countries could even turn a profit by exporting power, so long as it's converted to AC for transmission, right? Well, not necessarily. The problems Edison had with high-voltage DC were actually solved by the middle of the 20th century, and HVDC power lines have been in use ever since, because it turns out they're more efficient than AC at distances over 500 kilometers. Modern ones can even run between continents, like the project to build a seafloor cable carrying renewable energy nearly 4,000 kilometers from Morocco to the UK. And HVDC can connect regional grids, like the 5 serving most of North America, into a macro grid, making power cheaper and more reliable by increasing the range of sources it can come from. All of this suggests that Edison didn't lose the war of the currents, only the first battle. That doesn't mean that adopting AC was a mistake or that we should tear down the existing grid. But if we're going to build efficient, resilient, low-carbon economies around the world, we'll need more than just Westinghouse's alternating current or fleets of cars branded with Tesla's name. We'll also need to make better use of a technology which has taken more than a century to come into its own, Edison's direct current. Thank you.